Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 36th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you.
I need a point of order.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful, Commissioner. I think all of us, as members of this committee, received a letter addressed to yourself from Advice Talks, which I think raises some interesting issues. I'm just wondering if you could help us, how do you think the committee will take this forward?
Absolutely, thank you, Jeremy. Yes, we did all receive that correspondence. I had actually intended to raise this within the private session to allow committee members to discuss the letter, to discuss an approach going forward and agree next steps, such as formal consideration and how the committee will take it forward. So absolutely, we can discuss that.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you, Jeremy. Our next item is an evidence session on the Scottish Government's Budget 2023-24 with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and I welcome to the meeting Professor Graeme Roy, Professor David Ulf and Michael Davidson, Head of Social Security and Public Funding. Thank you very much for accepting the committee's invitation. So just a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we begin. For members attending remotely, please wait until I say your name before speaking. Colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question, and committee members online should use the chat box or the WhatsApp group. Before we move to questions, I'll invite Graeme Roy to make some opening remarks.
Good morning. Good morning, convener, and good morning, committee members. And thank you very much for the opportunity to come along and give you some evidence on our forecast we published last Thursday. Our report came at a time of when the near-term outlook for the Scottish and UK economies has weakened. The purchasing power of household incomes is anticipated to fall by the largest amount since Scottish records began in 1998. Inflation should peak at around about 11% by the end of this year, and that will outstrip earnings growth across the economy. High inflation and the recession will affect everyone, but there will be particular pressures on lower-income households, in part because they spend a larger share of income on essentials such as energy and food. Higher inflation also feeds through into our forecasts of Social Security spending, as the majority of payments are increased each year by inflation. The rate being applied in April 2023 is 10.1%, the level of CPI from September 2022. And this accounts for over £400 million of the increase in our forecast for spending for 2023-2024. We forecast that total Social Security spending will be £5.2 billion in 2023-2024, rising to £7.3 billion in 2027-2028. The increase in expenditure comes from more people receiving payments and, on average, people receiving higher payments over time. The overall difference between the funding the Scottish Government receives for Social Security from the UK Government and spending is estimated at £776 million in 2023-2024, growing to £1.4 billion in 2027-2028. And there are uncertainties around those forecasts, which I'm sure we'll pick up in the evidence session that, when we come to it. One of the main drivers, however, of the difference is the Scottish Child Payment, with forecast spending of £442 million in 2023-2024. And this is a major part of the Scottish Government's Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. But as a new benefit, there is no associated funding from the UK Government. There are also changes to disability benefits, which gradually increase spending over the forecast horizon. Most significant is adult disability payment, where we estimate that spending will exceed the equivalent funding by £208 million in 2023-2024, rising to £659 million in 2027-2028. As I said, this additional spending is more uncertain than other parts of our Social Security forecasts, as it's based on our assumptions and judgments of the impact of Scottish Government reforms. And finally, convener, in order to reduce the uncertainty in our forecasts, it is important for us to receive timely and detailed data on disability benefits in Scotland. And I wrote to you last week to provide you with an update on our access to this data. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will move straight to questions from members, and I will bring in Paul McLennan to kick us off.
Yeah, thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Doesn't seem that long since we had you in front of us the last time, and still the same issues. I think you've touched on a couple of issues right at the start. One was talking obviously about the cost of uprating, which is included in the block grant adjustment, and to what extent does inflation create a risk to the Scottish budget? The second question really is just talking about the current level of uncertainty in inflation forecasts. You talked around about the rate being 11% and obviously impacting on those in lower incomes. I just wonder if you can say a little bit more particular in about food inflation. Food inflation has obviously been predicted to be high and has been higher. So I just wonder if you can touch on that aspect as well. I'll probably just come to yourself first of all.
Okay, that's great. Yeah, okay. So I'll give you a high-level answer and I'll bring in my colleague as well to pick that up. So you're right. So one of the big differences, I think, in this time around and perhaps into previous years when doing the forecast is the effects of inflation and, in particular, how that feeds through to the uprating of Social Security payments. And you'll see, I think, in our report, figure 5.1 shows the increase of 3.6 billion, in of which about 1.2 billion is coming through from inflation. And that is obviously adding to quite a significant amount of the additional expenditure that we think will happen in the years ahead. In terms of the risk to the Scottish budget, because of the way the fiscal framework works, the benefits, the Social Security benefits that have the equivalent benefit in the rest of the UK are also being uprated by an equivalent amount, and then via the block grant adjustment that feeds through to the Scottish budget there. So on that basis, there isn't a risk there in the sense that the significant uplifting that's happening has an equivalent BGA. There are two caveats to that which are worth highlighting. Firstly, inflation isn't just having an impact on the Social Security element of the budget, but it's obviously having an impact on the broader Scottish budget more generally, and that's probably shown most starkly. If you look at the totality of spend, we think it's going up, it will go up by about 1.7 billion next year, but in total, that's only about 279 million once you account for inflation. So the amount of capacity elsewhere in the budget to potentially cope with additional changes in Social Security is being squeezed. So that's a potential risk that it exists there. And then the final part is that the elements of the Social Security payments that don't have an equivalent BGA, so things like Scottish Child Payment in the future, things like additional changes the Scottish Government has made to existing benefits that don't have an equivalent part of the BGA, then that is not factored into the forecast. And I think we have a chart on figure 5.10 shows you that by the end of the forecast, about 185 million that is equivalent in that context. So that's the broad answer to your first part. But maybe I'll hand over to David, who can maybe add anything additional to that and maybe pick up that question you've had about food inflation, if that's okay.
Okay. Let me just make a few points in addition to the ones that Graham made. So just to get this in context, the uprating for inflation in 23-24 only accounts for 28 million of the 776 million. Estimate of the funding gap. So the proportion of the funding gap that's accounted for by the uprating from inflation is quite small for next year. And for 27-28, the corresponding figures are that out of a total funding gap of 1.4 billion, the uprating only accounts for 185 million of that funding gap. So the amount of the funding gap that's attributable to uprating is actually very small, both next year, but also through into 27-28. And a useful figure that you might want to bear in mind in thinking about this is that for every additional 1% increase in inflation, that adds about just over £10 million, to the funding gap in the year in which that happens, but also in every subsequent year after that. Because an important aspect of uprating for inflation is that it's a persistent effect. Once you uprate the level of benefit, that higher benefit applies forevermore after that. We haven't broken out the amount of the uprating that's attributable specifically to food. I don't know, Michael, do you have any figure for that? But you're right, it is a very serious component.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose if it's not broken down, I suppose anecdotal. I mean, we've seen various forecasts and various estimates come through saying it's probably nearer 15% rather than 11%, and another essential is probably nearer 20% rather than 11% sort of thing. And I suppose it's diving a little bit deeper into impact and particularly lower paid when they're having to spend a proportionate amount on food than anybody else. And that's a real thing I think we need to be aware of in terms of what we're looking at. So.
The important part here is that there are different inflation rates for different people in the population, and it depends very much on what prices are going up and what proportion of the budget that accounts for those people. And in this case, because inflation is largely driven by energy prices, and that's having a knock-on effect on food prices as well, those are very high proportions of the budgets of poorer people. And so that's why it really, really matters for poor people. And their effective inflation rate is much higher than for the average.
Just on that, if it's okay, is the Fiscal Commission looking at doing something more specific around about that in the future? Because you mentioned around about proportionately it's a higher part of their income. But is that something that the Commission could do a little bit more deeper dive into, for example, and say that there is that more specific impact because people on a lower decile of income? Because again, I think that really impacts on about the work we're looking at. I know we're talking about anecdotal, but is there a more specific piece of work that the Commission could do on that or is looking to do something on?
Well, there are other bodies like the Institute for Fiscal Studies that produce studies of this, and we do cite some of their work in our reports, and we do try to highlight these distributional breakdowns of the effects in our reports. But because a lot of our stuff is at quite a high aggregate level, it doesn't necessarily drive quite a lot of the forecasting we do. But wherever we think it's relevant, we will try to bring that in. Graham, do you want to answer that?
So to say, I agree with, you know, that it's a challenge in terms of the effects of inflation there. So a couple of points on that. One is, you know, David's right around, and you're right as well, about the different inflation effects that people face. There's also a bit about what's the proportion of that to people's income. So how much of it can you then adjust your behaviours because of that? So if you have high earnings and high savings, then you can flex your expenditures and behaviours much more easily than you can do if you don't have levels of income. So it is an issue. In terms of, as Dave was saying, in terms of our forecasting, because we're looking at the macro picture, we tend not to go down to that level. It's actually one of the issues where there's a gap in UK statistics about different inflation rates across the country. So there's increasing work going on to look at different inflation rates across individual household types. But we don't have different inflation rates for different parts of the UK. So there isn't an inflation rate for Scotland published. There isn't an inflation rate for the rest of the UK. And again, one final thing in there as well is not only do we know that there are different price levels in inflation for households, but even within Scotland, so energy costs in rural areas are much higher than they are in other parts of the country. So it just adds to your complexity point that you're raising there.
Thank you. Thanks, Camino.
Thank you very much, Paul. We'll now move to questions from James Dornan, who's joining us online.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask, I notice that the SFC have talked about forecasts for increasing applications for disability benefits. Are there similar trends in Scotland as it is in the rest of the UK?
So there's a couple of things. In terms of the recent increase that we've seen in trends towards people who are increasing applications, and you've probably seen quite a lot recently about the significant increase in PIP applications in the whole of the UK. And broadly speaking, we're seeing similar trends in that context between Scotland and the rest of the UK. And there's quite a helpful chart, figure 5.5 in our report, which shows you that jump up in applications to PIP in Scotland. And broadly speaking, we're seeing that same increase in inflows over the time period. Perhaps maybe bringing David to maybe give you some work that we've been doing to try and think about what that might be driving that.
Yes, we've been thinking about the range of factors that might be driving this. And in our report, we identify essentially three sets of drivers. One driver is actually the cost of living crisis, and that operates in two ways. One is people having cost of living pressures will be much more likely to apply for as much whatever money might be available for them. So that tends to increase the number of applications for any type of social security. But if they think they're eligible for disability benefits, they will apply for them in cases where they might otherwise have done. But the other effect of the cost of living crisis is that it can create mental health problems for people trying to work out on how to cope with that crisis. So that will trigger a disability claim for mental health reasons. So cost of living itself will be one of the factors. Another factor driving this, we think, is the lengthening backlog in the NHS. So people who have a disability are waiting for treatment. Backlog in the NHS means they're not getting that treatment. And so a mild or medium condition can turn into a very serious condition, and one which will entitle them to disability benefits. And the third factor is just the long-term impact of the pandemic itself, both through some of the effects of long COVID might be having effects, particularly on mental health again, as a major component of disability benefit. But also through the other channels as well. And we know from the work we've done that about 40% of people claiming disability benefit do so for mental health issues. So these mental health effects of both the cost of living crisis and of the long-term impact of the pandemic are a serious component of what's driving up claims.
Thank you, James. Yeah, carry on, James. Thank you.
I would like to ask, does this change the estimate of how much more ADP will cost compared to continuing with PIP?
So I'll go first on that. So there's so a couple of things that we have to do when we are thinking about our judgment in this context is, to what extent have the increases that we've seen in PIP across the UK, how much of that is additional demand, or how much of that is demand for people that are already eligible taking it up? And our assessment at the moment is that we believe that actually this is mostly new demand. So this is mostly things that, as David said, are linked to things like the legacy effects of the pandemic. So on that basis, the increase that that we think will be coming through in this context and feeding ultimately through to ADP, because it will be mirrored at the UK, so it's a kind of proportionate in that context, there will be a BGA that will flow behind that. But that doesn't change our assessment that the changes that the Scottish Government are planning to do around adult disability benefit to make it a different system will unlock the potential increase in payments and eligibility from people who would already be eligible for that. So we make a slight adjustment in the short term around our forecast because we think there's a fixed number of people that are doing that, but it doesn't really change our assessment that we think there'll be additionality of people claiming these adult disability payments in the future, even with this spike up in PIP that we've seen in recent months. So the PIP increase is new demand, and then the adult disability payment, the extra funding element is from the actual changes in the new system.
Okay, thank you, that's fine. Thank you.
Thank you very much, James. I'll just bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in, who has a brief supplementary.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for answering questions so far and also for what you've shared in advance. I just want to pick up on two points you made there around mental health and the backlog in the NHS. Can you give a proportion of the increases accountable to or attributable to those two factors?
Well, unfortunately, we can't. We don't have enough data for a long enough period of time to be able to break this down. And the other problem in trying to break it down is that for many people there might be multiple factors at work in driving what's happening here. So those are the three elements I discussed. They might be the increase in uptake might be because of both cost of living pressures as well as mental health issues and other problems as well. So it's quite hard to disentangle these three effects and say exactly how many people are coming out from each. And we just don't have the data yet to track down to that level of detail.
Expect to get the data, or is it gathered?
I think we can do this for the stuff at DWP, mm-hmm. so we can look at the DWP data, because they have a very rich data source on this. So we can look at that and track that. So that gives us our baseline number of claimants, and we can see how far that is going up. And that's essentially what we're talking about here. We're not talking about the new people who are coming in because of the reforms mm-hmm. that the Scottish Government have made. Yeah. We're talking about essentially an increase to the baseline, so we can do some further analysis. But I say it's going to be difficult because there are many people for whom more than one factor will be in play here.
Thank you.
There is supplementary data we'll track as well, maybe not more on the Social Security payment side, on things like labour market data. So particularly the UK level, as long as we assume there might not be a difference between Scotland and UK in seeing this spike, you can track, and again in time, to see whether there's been, say, an increase in activity, and then people saying what that reason for that increase in activity has been, whether that be for ill health or whether that be for early retirement, etc. So we can start to, once we see changes in the labour market, get some more evidence in time to see whether or not we're seeing an increase in people saying they've got ill health conditions, which we can map across to see whether that is correlated with what we're seeing in the Social Security data. But it is, as David said, it's uncertain at this time. All we're seeing is the spike. Understanding generally what that is, what's driving that, is still uncertain at this stage.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you. That's convenient.
Thank you, Pam. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Thank you for coming along. This may be too early, but one of the forecasts you made, or your predecessor made, was that there would be a higher uptake of ADP compared to PIP. And I think Scottish Government have kind of budgeted on that because the system is meant to be kinder, fairer, smoother. Is it too early to see, is that a trend that we're seeing, that there are more uptakes in ADP compared to people who had been applying for PIP at DWP, or is it too early for that trend to show yet?
So, in short, it's too early. So, obviously, we've just had the pilot and then the initial rollout, and we'll get our first real cut of the data probably in the spring next year, and we'll start to see then about broad trends in that. But even then, it won't be robust enough for us to start to use into our forecasts. And I mean, and as we mentioned a couple of times there about the uncertainty, we're actually at this really tricky point in the forecasting period where we've got a completely new benefit, you know, approach to the benefit coming through the system, but until we actually start to get the data on take-up, data on the type of people they're doing, what are the inflows coming into that, what are the age profiles, what are the reasons for the claimants, until we get a decent track of that, we won't really know whether these things that we think might happen have really come through. So, in short, it's too early, but hopefully we should get this in the next year or so.
OK, that's helpful. I was just about to ask roughly when we should be looking for it. And will you be able to, or will we be able to kind of do some analysis to say, if we were still under DWP PIP scheme, we reckon X number would have got the award, but because it's ADP, either it's higher or lower than that. Well, will you be able to do that, or is that going to be almost too difficult to dig down on?
So I'll go first, and then David or Michael might want to come in. So, on the one hand, at a crude level, you can do that to an extent in the sense of comparing the BGA to the BGAs to the how much you're spending in ADP, and the difference, approximate difference of two will show you that. But what we really need is the quality of the data. So that's exactly what you're talking about there. All really depends on the quality of the data. So are we seeing differences in take up by different types of condition, or by age, or by, you know, by gender? All of these things it comes down ultimately to the quality of the data, and that's why we've been pressing so much on having that robust data as soon as possible, because it lets us answer these questions and then lets us start to change our forecast if we need to, depending on take-up and eligibility.
Just one thing to add to that is that the other people involved in this process are the OBR, because they're forecasting the block grant adjustment for this, which to some extent is what would have happened had the Scottish Government not made the reforms. And one thing that's happened over the last year is that we've managed to bring our forecast of that much closer to the OBR forecast. The problem is their methodology is very different from the methodology and the data that we've got. So we haven't been able to exactly mimic what they're doing. In some ways that's helpful. In some ways it's helpful to have two different people using two different approaches to the same thing. So the fact that we're now narrowing that gap means that we are starting to get better and better at forecasting what that... Essentially, it's a counterfactual. What would have happened had we not had those reforms made? And it is a relatively hypothetical number we're trying to forecast here. But the fact that these two methodologies are starting to converge gives us some reason to think we'll be able to do this better in the future.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Jamie. Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Can you touch on this? You mentioned about the funding gap previously, from being, I think it was 881 that had been forecast, and it's dropped slightly. I'm just wondered if there's any comment on, you want to touch on, you know, was there any specific reason for that at all? Probably to yourself.
Yeah. So there's a couple of things. So one is, and when we come on to this and we have the discussion about what we mean by funding gap, and in some ways the phrase funding gap is not always entirely helpful, because it creates the impression of a hole and a gap there. And actually, you know, none of this spending is ring-fenced by the BGAs. This is what the government chooses to spend priorities on across the entire suite of public spending, and then look at the revenues coming in there. So when we come back to that, when we discuss, because I think it is really important to be clear about what we mean by funding gaps in that context, but also the uncertainty there. So, but the difference between the BGAs and the amount of spending on that. So it's narrowed by about 106 million, I think, in 23-24. And I guess the kind of key reasons for that, one is the discussion we've had about PIP and ADP, and the fact that some of that increase that we were thinking of in ADP is being captured by what's happening on PIP in the UK. So there's an associated increase in the BGA relative to what we thought was going to happen because of the increases in PIP across the rest of the UK. And then there's a small, modest thing around child disability payment, where we don't yet have data to have updated our forecast from last year, but the OBR have increased their forecast for child disability payment across the rest of the UK. So that leads through to a higher BGA, and that's the other reason, the other key reason why the gap between the two has decreased.
Thanks.
Thank you, Paul. Oh, of course.
Although we haven't updated our forecast because of these data issues, the work we've done suggests that broadly we think the outturn data is in line with what we were forecasting there. So we haven't, that's why we haven't revised up or changed our forecast on CDP.
Thank you. I'll move now to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
My questions have largely been answered, with the exception of one small question. Thank you, Convener. I notice in the data, and forgive me if I'm misreading this, that there are assumptions that there will be no increase in winter heating payment or child winter heating allowance, and there will be less spending on Best Start grants. Can you say anything about the assumptions that have led to that?
So in the pensioner age winter heating payment, is that the one that you mentioned?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you want to maybe come in, David, yeah. Michael?
Yeah, so for those payments, I think it's just it's primarily, so the winter heating payment, that's our assumptions around what the Scottish Government's policy is going to be on uprating. So there's the group of policy of benefits where uprating is applied as a statutory process for that, but then for the other benefits it's sort of more on a year-to-year basis. There have been previously been decisions, so the dishes in this year, I think, for child winter heating assistance and for winter heating payment has been to apply uprating in 23-24 when those payments are made. But then we assume that following that, the policy will revert back to not uprating them in future years. So broadly for those benefits, so for the winter heating payment, the overall expenditure we forecast to stay level because, roughly speaking, the number of people that we expect to receive it will stay constant, and then also the payment level, once it's increased in 23-24, we keep it fixed for the rest of the horizon. Obviously, if policy changes, then we'll factor that into future forecasts, but that's sort of our understanding of what the policy is at the moment for that benefit. And that applies also, I think, to child winter heating assistance as well.
Thank you. So just to check that you don't think there'll be an increase in child winter heating assistance applicants?
Broadly speaking, I think for the child winter heating assistance applicants, I think there could be some increases, but it very much lines up with our child disability payment forecast as well. So although that sort of increases a bit towards the end of the horizon, I think the increase there is more around the uprating rather than the actual number of children getting it. I think that's right. I'm just sorry, checking my caseload. Yeah, child disability payment. There is some increase in the caseload and for child winter heating assistance as well, but it's a fairly marginal increase, so that's why. So we've rounded the expenditure there to 5 million. There probably are increases within that, but the rounding, taking it to 5 million, probably makes it look flat there.
Okay, thank you. The reason I ask is just because it felt a little bit inconsistent with some of the information in the previous conversation about the increases in disability payments and then why that wouldn't therefore be seen driven through the child winter heating assistance. And also the cost of living conversation we had would appear to maybe consider more people may become eligible for some of the winter heating payments as well as a result of that. But you're working on the assumption that that won't be the case.
The winter heating payment is sort of a combination of benefits and mm-hmm. low income benefits, and although in our economic forecast I think we've got a slight increase in unemployment, a lot of the people that already sort of have low incomes will already be eligible through their low income benefits rather than sort of becoming unemployed. We think it's quite a marginal effect.
Yeah. That's helpful. Thank you. That was all I have on that theme. Thanks.
Thank you, Pam. Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. We've covered a lot of these questions, but I wanted to revert back to a point with regards to financial management and just wondered where you think the Scottish Government is developing that. And, Graeme, you hinted towards the use of the word gap in terms of funding. Where do you think the Scottish Government are in trying to manage this going forward?
So it's not for me to comment on how the Scottish Government are managing that. We do the forecasts and we set it out, and then therefore it's for the government to manage. So a couple of things, if I could say. So this phrase, the funding gap, I do think is quite challenging because it does create this impression of a gap here. And actually what the government are doing is setting out a totality of a budget now of different elements of spending, and then what they're doing on the revenue side, and then the balance between that, and then make the choices in social security and public services and tax there more generally. But what we do know is that that on policies such as the Scottish Child Payment, which are new policies which don't have an equivalent BGA, have to be funded for either through taxation or through adjustments in public services in other areas. And I think out of the funding, the funding difference, that's about 450 million by the end of the forecast period. You then have all these other benefits that have a BGA to it, and if you adopt a different approach, and it's about doing a different system, and that leads to higher take up and higher average payments, then that will have to be paid for, and that then again comes back to the point about what does that mean in terms of the balance of tax and the balance of public services that are in there. And I guess the point to not answer your question, but I think go as far as I am prepared to go, is to say that the government then need to essentially plan on that basis, just as they would do with all our forecasts, and say, well, this is what the independent assessment is of potential funding coming down the line. So then you have to plan for that. You have to think about your taxes. You have to think about your public spending in other areas, and ultimately think about the outcomes that you're trying to achieve. And that totality of all is the thing that is really important.
No, that's helpful, okay. I think.
To that, sure, which is sure. An important issue to think about when you're talking about managing this, is that the distinction between social security and other areas of government spending are that social security is essentially a demand-led form of payment, that once you've designed the policy, once you've designed the criteria, and then Social Security Scotland implement those policies, and once you've set the rates, the amount of money you actually goes out the door on this depends on the number of people who turn up and claim it. And that's not something which you can then control. That's why it's really important to try to think ahead and understand, albeit from our highly uncertain forecasts, what the potential implications would be for long-term funding and social security, because it's not something you can manage in the same way as health or education spending.
It's a very good point. And I think, you know, since we last met with yourselves, this projection of £106 million less gap, you know, is important, but it's a data question. I know we're coming on to those questions later on, but thanks very much. Thanks for coming up.
Thank you, Miles. Paul McLean.
Yeah, thank you. Can you kind of touch on forecast accuracy? And you've kind of highlighted it being from the 4% down to the 2%. And kind of mentioned that about two one-off factors. I don't know if you just want to say a little bit more around about that. And I suppose it's probably looking in the years ahead as well, how, you know, how difficult or how easy or how much easier is that going to be as you go ahead, kind of thing. And I suppose you've kind of touched on it as well as kind of looking around about how do you assess government policy when you're looking at this. In terms of, and how does that work, and can government work closer with you in that regard? You know, what's the relationship in that way as you develop that? I know it's meant to be almost a step back and looking at it, but could there be closer working between yourselves and Scottish Government in the forecast element of things?
Okay, I'll go first, and I'll hand over to David and Michael as well if they get anything. So you're right, the forecast accuracy down from 4% to 2%. The key reason for that really is just that when we first do our assessment of the forecast accuracy, we use provisional data, and then when we later on we get the fully audited data from Audit Scotland, and that identified a slight issue with the data that was in the provisional, and once you adjusted for that, then the forecast error comes down to 2%. To be honest, this is You get these sorts of things all the time between provisional and then ultimately it was audited. Clearly, ultimately, it's the audited ones that are the most important. It's just a timing issue that when we do our forecast evaluation report in the summer, that's not ready yet. When you look at what Audit Scotland said, they broadly said that the error they found was isolated, so that it's not a recurring thing that will happen. So that broadly explains that. Your broader point about uncertainty into the future, and I touched on this a wee bit with the answer to Jeremy Balfour around, we're in this, particularly with adult disability payment and child disability payment, we're in this really challenging period in the forecast element of setting up these new payments, in that we know what the policy are, they're now being rolled out, but we don't yet have the ex post data to see how these are affecting. So we've made, over a number of years in consultation with government and also through our own judgments about what we think might happen, about the changes in policies and drawing on evidence about what's happened in the past. But there is margins for error in that, and it will only be once we start to get the data coming through can we actually know, well, this is what's coming through additional take-up, or this is what's happening with additional eligibility, or this is what's happening with the payments. And we've just got to, in some ways, be patient about that, and we will start to know that. But that comes on to the data point. The better granular data we get, the sooner we get it, then we can start to make these assessments and do that. In terms of the relationship, so we obviously have a very close working engagement with an official level with the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland about the data. And I think since we wrote in the summer, we've had conversations with them about the data that we need, the types of information that we need. Also, during this forecast round, had really quite helpful discussions with senior colleagues in the government just on the qualitative side. So what's their sense about how things are going? Is there anything that they would say that actually we're finding something completely different to what we thought and what they did as well? So I think in this period, those sorts of positive, constructive discussions, I think, are really helpful. But ultimately, it'll be when we get the data that we can start to properly assess this and then see whether the programmes are having the transformation that they would hope to.
That's all right.
Thank you, Paul. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. Excuse me. Thank you, Convener. Just to take some of those questions a bit further, and actually, again, some of my questions have already been answered, but on the data point, what further data do you think you need from Social Security Scotland? You mentioned earlier about some of the data you get from the DWP being able to allowing you to make some further assumptions about the impact or the where the spikes are coming from. Do you expect that Social Security Scotland will gather similar data? Have you asked them for it? You'll know that we have Social Security Scotland in shortly, so it could be a timely opportunity for us to indicate if there were any areas that you felt they might need to consider.
Yeah, so just a really quick answer, I'll hand over to David, who's probably been working on this slightly longer than me. So we don't yet have the data, so obviously adult disability payment is just being rolled out, but child disability payment has been out since November, and we don't have the data that we need to change our forecast in there. So we don't know things like average payment award, we don't know things like the number of new clients and inflows coming in, and we really need that information in order to be able to assess what's going on there. We've written to Social Security Scotland in the summer, and we copied to the committee here about our statement of data needs and what we need. And the key point being not just the quality data we need for the new system, but it's the transition period that is really important to be able to see whether or not these changes in policies have a difference. But I'll hand over to David to give some kind of broader reflections on the work around data and what we need.
Well, going back again to child disability payment, one of the issues I think we talked about last time we talked to you was the issue about collecting data on the sex of the child. Now, that's not being done systematically by Social Security Scotland. Data about the sex of the child is just done through the qualities monitoring part of the application. It's not actually done as part of the application process itself. Now, that may not matter in terms of the amount of award that Social Security Scotland give people, but what might matter is if there are certain types of conditions which are more prevalent amongst, say, boys rather than girls, then being able to get data on the sex of the application of the applicant helps us understand whether those trends are there. It helps us better forecast to what extent there will be higher average awards because of the composition of the children. So one piece of work we will have to do at some point is, as we get enough data coming through the qualities monitoring form, try to see how well that matches up with other forms of data, say that has been collected by DWP through their process in England, to see whether there are systematic biases in the application that people who are choosing not to use the equalities monitoring form or systematically do that when it's a boy rather than a girl, for example. If there was a systematic bias there, that could really affect our forecast in the future. If what was coming through in the equalities monitoring form was broadly matching up with what would have happened on the application form, then over a period of time, it may not matter so much that we're not getting it through the application form. We can use what's there through the equalities monitoring portion, but we won't know that for a period of time. So unless Social Security Scotland were to change their policy, there will be an issue there about that form of data that will persist.
It's something we could ask them, but do you know why they made that decision?
I think it would be up to them to answer that question.
That's fair. Thank you. And on the data points that you raised, Professor Roy, as well, do you have Social Security Scotland said that they will be able to collect that data?
Get an update in the spring. So we, in part of the conversations, they said that we'll get basic data for child disability payment and adult disability payment in the spring. As I said, we're in this challenging time where even on adult disability payment, because it's only just started, we don't know whether what we get is actually genuinely reflective of the longer term trends that we'll need. It'll be slightly better than the child disability payment because we'll have it running for a longer period of time. So on the timing part, it'll probably another year or so before we can say much more confident on the adult disability payment part. But the data we get in spring will be really important, and we'll know then about how granular it is, how comparable it is to DWP data, how the transition has been handled, so we can track people coming through from moving from one to another to see whether there's been any changes in there. So the spring is probably going to be, that data released to us is probably going to be really important to see how robust it is and how helpful it is in order to assist the forecasts.
Are there any obvious differences that you already know between the data that's collected at DWP and Social Security Scotland, other than what we've just discussed?
Yeah, I think broadly really what we've discussed, I said, well, once we get it, I think will be the key thing to track it through. As I said, I think the sorts of information that we'll need, like average payment, like the payment flows, all of those things will be the things that really help for the forecasting. Because then we can then start to say, well, like, this is what's been captured. So if we then make these assumptions going forward about cost of living or about take-up or about eligibility, then we can start to adjust that. So once we get the data, it will be when we can really make an assessment on that.
Thank you.
Can I just add a point that an important issue here is not just about collecting the data, it's also about publishing the data, because we like to base our forecasts on published data so that if somebody else wants to go out there and try to replicate our forecasts, they can do so. This is all part of our mission, to be very transparent about how we produce our forecasts. So we always tend to rely on published data rather than data that's given to us through the back door, as it were. So it's really quite important that Social Security Scotland doesn't just collect the data, but finds tools and techniques to publish that data. And DWP have a well-developed tool called StatExplore, which they use to make their data available. So if Social Security Scotland could develop a similar tool, that would be really helpful to us.
You're relying on data just now that isn't published?
And again, that's something you'd have to pursue more with them, but okay. At the moment we don't see that coming along.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, I can answer that. Our understanding is that, yes, the volume of data that Social Security Scotland will publish on child disability payment will increase, but we're not sure whether the data they provide in March will be published at the same time as they're able to provide it to us for the forecasting.
Thank you. That's helpful. Thanks. Have no further.
Thanks, Pam. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. Just following up that similar theme, but in regard to adult disability payment. I think on page 91 of your report you state, we are concerned that CDP data discerning issues will carry over to adult disability statistics. Again, what conversations have you had with Social Security Scotland in regard to that? How reassured are you? Obviously, Social Security Scotland are in after you this morning. Is this something that we should be pursuing, or are you content with what you're hoping to get?
So I think that phrase in there is essentially saying, is broadly saying, well, the access to the quality data we need on child disability payment is this exact, broadly speaking, the same issues that we need for adult disability payment. The magnitudes are much bigger, though, which is why it's, from a funding point of view, rather than a Social Security point of view, from a funding point of view, that's why it's really, really important on that. As I said, I think our statement of data needs still stand, so the letter that we wrote in the summer and the request for the data is still the key thing. We don't have that data, so we've not been able to update our forecast this time around because we don't have the data. We've been engaging with Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Government to impress on the need for getting that data, and we've had constructive conversations with them over this time period, but we don't have the data. We're told it will get updated data, usable data in March, basic data, but until we get that, then we don't really know. So I think, as I said, I think we've written on statement of data needs, and any support in strengthening that request for data needs would be very welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam.
Thank you, Jeremy. We'll move now to Paul McLennan to finish us off for this session.
And thank you, panel. And I just want to bring you back, Professor Wright, to the point you made right at the start of talking about the fiscal framework. And I suppose it's maybe more your thoughts on the fiscal framework. Part of the issue, I think, for myself, is the complexity of the existing fiscal framework. And I know there's discussions ongoing at the moment between the Scottish Government and UK Government. From the Commission's point of view, what would make that? What are your asks, I suppose, of these discussions, and what would make your life simpler in terms of your work in regards to the fiscal framework, in reference to the point you made right at the start, saying part of the issues is in about the fiscal framework. So it's maybe your asks and what would make it easier for you in terms of the discussions, because obviously Social Security, there's a lot discussions between the UK Government and Scottish Government and so on. So what would make it easier in terms of the fiscal framework for you?
Yeah. So, first of all, you expect me to say this, but obviously it's a government negotiation around the fiscal framework ultimately, and it's for the two governments to decide on that. A broader point I think I would make...
Avoiding the politics, what would your message be to the two, and what are the key things that you would like to see them discuss, without going into the actual specific details?
So I think as an outside organisation into all of this, one of the things that I think I've been struck by, and I think that we now got a much better handle on, is the uncertainty that exists in fiscal and economic forecasting. And I don't think we really thought too much about that back in 2016 when this was being designed, for good reason, about setting up a framework. And I think this is why the review was always designed to be quite timely after, you know, 5-6 years of the framework being agreed, that could look back and say, actually, how is it coping? Are the levels of borrowing and forecasting, all those sorts of things, as designed as perhaps we would hope they've been or thought they would be? So I think for me, I think key part of the looking back on the fiscal framework review and thinking about it is that you know, is this how much uncertainty we thought? Is this the movability going into this that we thought? Part of that is because we've been through this quite exceptional economic period. Who would have thought that back then you would have Brexit, cost of living crisis, war in Ukraine, a global pandemic. So there's lots of economic uncertainty in there. But we've now got a much better handle. That's where our forecast evaluation reports are really quite good, about how things are moving around. So how things potentially are moving around on the income tax forecasts, on the economy forecasts, and on Social Security. So I think my advice on that would be is to, when they're looking at the fiscal framework review, is to actually look at our evidence and say, well, actually, given the movability and given how this is impacting on the potential projections for funding, do we have the right tools? Do we have the right flexibilities to manage this? Do we have the freedoms to adjust all of this that we think we would like to have? And then it's ultimately for them to decide whether or not that's the case or not.
That's really useful. Thank you. Thanks, Professor May.
Can I just add 2 points? Just going back on the last point that Graham made, is that I think we've made this point in some of our reports, is that it is striking that the borrowing limits and the limits of what can be paid into and drawn down in the reserves don't vary with the size of the budget. So
I have raised this in this committee, as other members know, so that's again very interesting to hear and Harlan to know, so thank you for that.
Yeah, but a second observation is that what we see is there's a learning process taking place here. All our discussions with the Scottish Government suggest that they're really starting to learn how to think about managing some of this uncertainty that Graham was talking about, looking ahead and seeing when is a big reconciliation coming along, when can we think about doing various things with various other elements of funding we've got to try to land that particularly well. So there has been a learning process taking place here, and I think we're all getting a bit smarter doing this stuff.
Okay, appreciate that. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Paul. And thank you all for providing evidence this morning. It's been very helpful, especially in advance of our next session. So I will briefly suspend to allow the setup of our next panel. And thanks again. Welcome back, everyone. The committee will now take evidence from Social Security Scotland on its performance and operation. So I welcome to the meeting David Wallace, Chief Executive, James Wallace, Deputy Director for Finance and Corporate Services, and Janet Richardson, Deputy Director for Client Services Delivery. I'll invite David Wallace to make any opening remarks before we begin with questioning.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, members. I'm grateful to the committee for inviting me to give evidence today. With me is Janet Richardson and James Wallace, who I believe most members will have met. So it's just over a year since I last appeared before committee, and once again it's been a hugely significant year for Social Security Scotland. We launched adult disability payment, the most complex benefit that Social Security Scotland has yet delivered. And I was pleased to welcome some committee members to our Dundee headquarters in the spring to hear about our preparations. By the end of October, we had received over 18,000 Part 2 applications, which we are working through as quickly as possible. This has come alongside work to transfer existing awards for PIP and Child Disability Living Allowance to Social Security Scotland, and we have already transferred over 34,000 clients, making sure they experience no breaks in payment. And last month, we extended Scottish Child Payment to children under 16, receiving 123,000 applications in less than a month. Social Security Scotland has grown rapidly over the last year. With over 4,000 staff now in post, we have completed our volume recruitment, meaning that we are well positioned for our live benefits and the new winter heating payment from next February. Obviously, we don't do this alone. Our colleagues in the core Scottish Government continue to deliver the systems and processes we need to administer our benefits and work with ministers on the policy of devolved benefits. As always, therefore, I won't be able to comment on policy decisions. While we have grown and changed as an organisation, I'm pleased to see some consistency as well, both in the commitment of our staff and, most importantly, the standard of service we offer to clients. Social Security Scotland saw the second highest engagement score of any civil service organisation in 2021, People Survey, and I was heartened at our latest client survey that 94% of respondents said when asked that they were treated with kindness. Of course, much remains to be done. We are just past the midway point of the biggest agile delivery programme in the history of Scottish devolution. Our systems and processes are still developing. And I welcome the Audit Scotland in their recent report commenting on the focus on continuous improvement, which is very much at the heart of our operation. And finally, with the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecasting that Social Security Scotland will be responsible for over £5 billion of benefit expenditure next financial year, including direct support to over a million clients, the importance of this work will only grow. So I look forward to answering any questions.
Thank you very much, David. We'll move straight to questions from members, and I will bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in first.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for your opening statement. Audit Scotland have said in the report, and we've heard a bit this morning as well about data collection, but they've said there's inherent uncertainties about staffing. Can you explain a bit about what they are, what you're doing around staffing, and do you expect some of the spending reductions announced recently to have an impact on the staffing levels in Social Security Scotland?
So I think the first part of that, the uncertainties are as they've always been. So I was reading the Spice briefing, just reflecting back on my appearance last year. So they remain the same. Clearly, there is still policy behind benefits being developed. There are still systems behind benefits being developed until they come to us for implementation. So these are always going to be variables and uncertainties until we actually know what the system is going to look like. So I think that's the main driver around about the staffing level of the organisation. The more that technology does, the fewer staff that we need. The more that we've got manual processes, the more staff that we need as well. So that's fundamentally going to be always the case. In terms of the budget and our position, I believe we are in a good, strong position in terms of the administration costs of the organisation. So Janet may want to say more, but we're in a good position in terms of those benefits that are close to being implemented, so winter heating payment. With carers allowance replacement, obviously we're a bit further away, and we'll still need to work with colleagues around about exactly what that looks like before we can say what staffing looks like.
Thank you. Appreciate that. This morning, in terms of operations and budgets, we heard some information from the Fiscal Commission about data collection. Firstly, what plans do you have to collect data on the average payments, the payment flows, the transition? I know there'll be a transition period in all of this, but going into next year, what plans do you have to collect that, and do you plan to publish that data?
So there's probably two things. I'll come to the Fiscal Commission point probably last then. So we have started our series, as with all benefits, of publishing statistical information. So we will continue to do that for adult disability and child disability in particular on that sort of three-monthly cycle. So we have always had those plans to do that. And that gives a degree of depth around about the volumes of applications, the processing times, all those types of information. The Fiscal Commission have been looking for some quite specific information to assist with their forecasting. And if you'd want me to say a little bit more about that at the moment, we have been working really closely with the Fiscal Commission. Last week, we started some of the reporting that they want to see so that we can draw out the information from our systems, quality assess it before we can give it to Fiscal Commission. But it has never been a case, just to be absolutely clear, that we are sitting on information that we have not shared with the Fiscal Commission. The Fiscal Commission are asking for information that we are not seeing. So the process has been to go back, work with our Social Security programme colleagues, code the system in a way that we can extract what they're looking to see. So there's probably two slightly different levels there. I suspect some of the information Fiscal Commission will want to see won't necessarily be appropriate for our statistical publication. So there'll be a kind of twin-track approach to that.
And at the minute, do you think the Fiscal Commission are relying on data that's published, or is it mainly data that you're making privately available to them?
It's a bit of both, a bit predominantly the published information up to now. I think I caught a little bit of the Graham Roy's evidence beforehand, so I would echo some of the stuff he said. I think it's the early days of it. So for adult disability, we really just don't have any of the depth of data. It's not a case even of trying to find specific data that they're looking for. The system is just in such an early state that we don't know what the flows look like yet. We're working with Fiscal Commission of what they need. And I think one of the things that we have been trying to do far more with the Fiscal Commission is to give a little bit more of the soft intelligence, which in the absence of some of those hard figures, they've been quite keen to understand. So colleagues each side of me have been involved in some of those rounds of forecasting with the Fiscal Commission. And that can be, you know, some of the behavioural stuff that we're seeing, even down to some of our marketing communications activity. They can find that information quite valuable. So not all of it is hard stats, but inevitably there will be some as well.
And did you do any work initially with the DWP to look at the sort of data that they gather to give intelligence, not just for their operations, but also for the future of forecasting? And how much of that did you consider to replicate? And if you didn't replicate it, why did you make those choices?
Our analysts have always worked quite closely with DWP. So like everything else, what we have been delivering is through an agile delivery, as I said in my opening statement. This is the biggest agile delivery I think the Scottish Government has done since devolution. There is always that balance around about paying money to citizens that they need, versus, you know, having a fully fledged system in the background to do everything that we would like to see. So the data collection for Fiscal Commission is just one of those things. Janet, certainly from an operational perspective, we'd like to see lots of suites of information as well. So it is not simply a case of, this is surprised or we've ignored something in it. There's an inevitable consequence of the way that we are delivering. And I don't mean that in any sense, a form of criticising. It is a feature of Agile in the same way that some other elements we might come on and talk about, you know, technical debt is a feature of an Agile delivery system. So we have never been in a position to say we will have everything in place that we need and then we'll start delivering benefits. That has simply not been the approach that we've taken.
Do you know when you will have the information, when those systems will have the information that you need to collect built into them?
So there's probably, again, two things. There's a tactical solution to that. So I say tactical work on that has already begun. We had a successful deployment last week, which had let us see some of those reports, and our analysts are quality assuring that before we can give that data to Fiscal Commission. I think there's a further bit of work about replicating, as you say, what's available in, from the DWP, and they have a very mature, advanced statistical system where interested users can manipulate information directly. That is a much more strategic, longer-term bit of work. So we have set up with our programme colleagues a user group which is now looking at those longer-term use of stats. So for the Fiscal Commission, we've undertaken to try and get what information we can to them for the next round of forecasting, and that work is already well underway. That replicating, as it were, of what the DWP have in place will be a longer-term bit of work.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. We have a supplementary from Jeremy Balfour on that point.
Thank you, Camilla, and good morning, David, and to your team. Good to see you again. I'm just a wee bit confused because, obviously, you know, this is a system that we've designed from scratch. Now, I appreciate it was designed by Scottish Government, who you are now working it with, but it would have thought to me, as a kind of amateur IT person, you would want to start at the very beginning with getting the same information, data, that DWP are collecting, so that we can compare apples with apples. So what you're saying to us is that we're not going to be able to compare for ADP what would have happened with DWP. If people had stayed on PIP compared to now on ADP, we won't be able to compare that information because you're not recording it in the same way as DWP, which means from a kind of scrutiny panel perspective, how can we know the information is then going to help us ask the questions we get, because it's not the same information we're comparing. And I don't quite see why we didn't design it from the start so that we could compare the same information.
Sorry if I've not explained that correctly. So I think at a basic level of, you know, the number of people applying, what level of award they're getting, what condition they're getting for, yes, that's information that's recorded. The point about agile development was that what we don't have is a sophisticated bit of software that we put all of that data in that allows external users to manipulate it in a way that they might want to do that. And that has been just a functionality that we have not had from day one in the system. The systems are different, obviously, and so, you know, the systems won't replicate themselves exactly. So DWP will collect data, for example, on the outsource assessments, you know, how, you know, the passage of time between outsourcing an assessment to it coming back in. These things simply just don't exist in our system, so we will never replicate that because the processes are different. But in terms of you know, level of award, how many people are getting which elements of award, how many people are taking up multiability scheme, those elements of course are things that we will be able to monitor and compare, and we've been able to do some of that very early comparison with it. I think what one of the things that Fiscal Commission are looking for is sort of point-in-time data about awards almost in real time, and that's what we simply don't have the functionality to give at the moment. But there are clear comparables. We want and we need to be able to compare the systems in terms of outcomes, but there will be some differences in what we monitor.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you, Jeremy. James Dornan.
Thank you, panel. I'd like to ask some questions about the processing times for the Scottish Child Payment. Can you tell us what's the current processing time for applications received ended in 14?
I didn't possibly catch the end of that, but I think it was around about current processing time for Scottish Child Payment. Is that correct?
Very much, since the benefit was extended on the 14th of November.
I mean, it really is too early to say, since the benefit was extended in particular to clients with children up to age 16. One of the reasons for that is when we extended that, we worked really closely with our Scottish Government and programme colleagues, and the change of that system shouldn't be underestimated, just how significant of technology advance that was as well. So Scottish Child Payment Extension for the first time brings with it a degree of automating and straight-through processing. So of those 123,000 applications I mentioned in my opening statement, a number of those applications will effectively run straight through the system. And since we've brought those into the organisation, we would expect those to be a very, very short period of time. However, those cases that fall out will require a degree of manual intervention by some of Janet's team. Therefore, it's at the moment, there would be a very wide range of what a typical processing time looks like. We'll, as routinely, we'll be publishing the statistical publication which kind of says that out, and I think the next one's due in early new year, and that would be the first sort of reflection as to what the November intake has done for us. I'll maybe just bring Janet in, if that's okay, just to say a little bit around about how we're doing that, what that feels like. But it is worth saying, just before I do, this is the biggest intake of applications the organisation has ever had. You may recall when we initially launched Scottish Child Payment, we took a mechanism that allowed people to apply slightly early so that we could get our hands on the application in preparation for it. This time round, we have not done that, despite the numbers being more significant. And it was that reliance and straight-through processing that we need to have a significant chunk of those applications go straight through the system. But I don't know, Janet, if you want to add to that.
Yeah, thank you. Good morning, convener and members. Thank you. I think, really, just in addition to what David has said there, you know, over 80,000 of those applications came in within the first 2 days, so it just shows what a huge number of people are waiting for this benefit, and we don't underestimate that. And we are doing as much as we can to process them quickly. And tens of thousands of people will receive that benefit before Christmas, but some will not. And we've made that very clear to clients that we will do our very best, but we can't guarantee that. We are keeping clients updated by text and using social media on what we are doing. But we will, as David said, be able to give more of a processing time figure early in the new year.
Thank you for that. Can I ask, is there any obvious way for you to improve the processing times or to help clients track progress of their application? For example, it's been mentioned that an online app or account might help with that. Would it improve them? And if so, would you be implementing it?
My personal view is that automation is the way to improve some of the processing times, and continuous improvement on automation is a theme we'll come back to, absolutely, to do that. As I said, the internal automation of some of these applications is the first time that we've done that with the extension of Scottish Child Payment. The client-facing sort of portal is something that we are working with programme colleagues on as well. My personal opinion would be yes, that would assist. In some way, at least, it would let people who are able to track online get a sense of where their application was, and inevitably, if they're able to do that, it reduces the demand on Janet's front-facing contact centres and makes sure that we're able to kind of process applications quicker. But as always, with everything that we're doing with Social Security, our programme colleagues will do some work. So we've got some of that client feedback, I think, from the client survey. But we'll do a little bit more research as to whether that would help us as well. But my personal view is yes. I think people are used to seeing sort of progress tracking in an automated way, and those that are technically able to do that, we'd probably find that helpful. But we'll see what users have tell us around about it. Again, I should absolutely emphasise the programme of delivery work for benefits, as I've said previously, this committee is, from our perspective, is incredibly pressurised and incredibly tight. So a new bit of technology, we'd need to find a way into that timetable somehow. We don't have a separate magic way of producing that to the side of the main delivery of benefits.
OK, it's coming up to Christmas, maybe Santa. Thanks very much for that response. Thank you.
Thank you very much, James. Bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in now, thanks.
Thank you very much, convener, and let's hope Santa can deliver. I guess the first thing I'd say is it's having that online capability for people to check was probably one of the few things that people liked about the universal credit system. Is there a reason why you didn't build that in from the start, or is it back to the agile methodology problem?
I think it's back to the agile methodology. So I would agree with you. And I think, you know, it's come through for a couple of years now in that client survey that, yes, people who are, comfortable and familiar online do find that, and you know, experience in other places as well. So are used to it in, you know, dealing with commercial utilities or others. So I think it's a logical thing for us to explore. But you're absolutely right. The reason why we don't have it comes back to the same point about statistics. You know, what are the things we've been operating on, what's called a minimum viable product, and we've sort of been layering this up as benefits come on board. So, you know, we've had 4 years in essence of a minimum viable product's being built up, and every time we do that, more functionality comes into place. But this has never been a place of developing one system then running a benefit live as well. I could say a little bit more about that if that's helpful, because, you know, I think one of the things that's also different, certainly from the DWP, is we have one base system underpinning all of our benefits. So, you know, we don't build a system for Scottish Child Payment, we don't build a system for Best Art Grants and sort of add it into the organisation. There is a single platform. So every time now that we're dropping more functionality, the testing of that platform is something that becomes more and more difficult and complex every time that we do that. The amount of time we've got to do that without bringing down operations and closing that to the public becomes more and more pressurised. So we try and do that over a sort of a weekend period. So all of this is a balance. It's a balance about, you know, do we want to wait for clients to be able to see progress of their applications online, or do we extend the Scottish Child Payment? It's some of these choices that we have to make.
I understand that those. Yeah, I can see that because of the choices that have been made so far. I know that. I mean, there are countless problems with the DWP and the way that they do things. I get that, not least policy, obviously. But one, I can't. Can you explain why there was a decision taken not to just lift the technology that they use and apply it to the policy and the specifics for Scotland, rather than completely start from scratch and then face the situation you've just described, which is shut down the system for the weekend to try and catch up and inevitably continue to have to bolt on additional bits to IT and have a what appears to be a bit of a substandard system?
I would probably disagree with the point it's substandard. I think that there are pros and cons to it. I don't think the option, as a DWP, it isn't a single system. You know, there is no single system that we could have looked at and said, if we take that, that will support all of our benefit deliveries. So, and this is one of the challenges we come to when we talk about data with DWP. Again, it's because you're scanning lots and lots of different systems, some of them quite old, some of them themselves going through transformation programs. So that it wasn't as simplistic as saying there's a thing here that if we could just lift or replicate, we could bring here and it has all the functionality attached to it. That's, you know, DWP systems have grown up over decades in different ways for different benefits. That there wasn't an option that simply said there's a thing at the core here that we want to replicate. We have ended up with a primary contractor, an IBM, who do work with DWP. So again, at the heart of this is a bit of technology that is working in elements of DWP. So we have gained advantages of understanding how that replicates. But there just simply was never a thing which said, take system X and bring it up and replicate it. And we've had both benefits and disadvantages of that not being available. But all these options were looked at the very early stages of the programme, and there simply wasn't a thing to lift and shift.
That's helpful to understand that. Thank you. One final question on this is around the about, I think, 200,000 applications for the Scottish Child Payment were expected when the increase came on, about 89,000, I think, are the figures that that happened. What happened to the other people? And do you know if it's, like, what information have you got about those missing people, and how much of it is to do with the fact that the website was either being undergoing some development or crashed or whatever happened? Have you looked into that?
So if I take the numbers one first, so I think the 200,000 was about children that was being quoted. That's the Fiscal Commission's number, around about the number of children that we'd expect to be benefiting from it. So the 123,000 applications is applications. Some applications will be for more than one child. So actually we won't know how many children those 123 applications represent until we're, as the previous question had asked, got some further statistics and threw the system on it. to give you some illustration, until we'd extended Scottish Child Payment, the ratio was approximately 1.3. So that meant for every application, we had about 1.3 children included in the applications. Naturally, we'd expect that to grow a bit, given the age range have increased significantly. So within those 123,000 applications will be more than 123,000 children. So we need to understand what that, if there is a gap, what that gap looks like. But again, in the early days of this, we need that to flow through the system before we've got that information.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that. Thanks.
Thank you, Pam. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Commissioner. I'm just a couple of questions, if that's okay. In the Charter, it says one of the measures in the Charter is the percentage of applications processed within 10 working days. And I think in 2021-22, the majority of claims weren't processed within this time framework. I'm just wondering, firstly, why that is the case, and are you hoping to do better next year? And if so, what target are you looking to set yourself for the coming year?
So I think we've always been, as you're aware, quite careful about trying to set a target, mainly on because if it drives the wrong type of behaviour. So the 10 days, again, in the customer charter, I think is quite an ambitious measure. So it's right that we measure it, but I think it was always going to be a relatively small proportion of cases that we'd hit that 10-day figure. The thing about the customer charter, I guess, is the balance of all of those measures. So making sure that how people are treated, the outcome matters and all the rest of it. So the 10 days, I think, is going to be incredibly challenging for particularly disability-related benefits, low-income benefits, and I'll maybe just bring Janet on this, the automation that we've referred to, both in terms of straight-through processing, but also multiple benefits on a single application. These things will help drive down those dates. I think when Janet was in front of the committee supporting the minister previously, I think we were having a period during the summer where I think our processing time was too long, and Janet had covered at the point there some of the activity we're trying to do to drive that down, and it will be continuous improvement of the organisation, it will be automation, it will be focusing on some of these things. So the 10-day was never a target that we would try to sort of work to. It's right, it's in the charter, and it's important, but I think it's one of those things which we need to balance it off with the other measures, so the 94% measure, which I would say as well.
I mean, if you could have a charter, I think that's quite a reading comment there, to say, we're just never going to hit this figure, or we're not going to get most of it done. So what is a realistic time application? So if I put an application in for ADP, what is my expectation?
So we're doing a bit of the work at the moment with clients for exactly that. And I know we faced some criticism when we took down the sort of the 8 to 10 weeks indicator from the website. And the reason we did that was to not mislead clients as to what was to be expected. So 10 days will not be achievable for disability benefits, not least we have changed the system. We are in a position now where we are collecting information on behalf of clients. So I cannot see how we will get to a position where the vast majority of disability benefits would be achieved within a 10-day turnaround. But we are working with clients now for exactly what those expectations are, and also how best it would be to relay those expectations as well. So is it a static website indicator? Do they want something more dynamic? Is it text that we give a more regular update of where we are with processing? But there are a number of measures in the charter which I think balance out, and it's important. So I'm certainly not dismissing making timely decisions is really important. It absolutely is, and I think we saw that over the summer, that we were getting to a level where both individual clients and stakeholders were unhappy with that service.
I think that's probably something we as a committee need to go back and discuss with Scottish Government, because I think if we've got a charter and people read that charter, if we're never going to hit these figures, then it's almost not worth the paper it's written on. If I can just move on very quickly to just one other area. I mean, back in October, as you said, your colleague Janet came and gave evidence. And one of the things she said there was, we recognise with applications opening so near Christmas, people will be concerned about getting the money by then. So clearly this was an issue that you were thinking about back in the autumn of this year. On Facebook yesterday, you put up this comment to your clients. Because of the volume of applications, some people who applied in the week may not get a decision until early 2023. What discussions did you have with Scottish Government to say we cannot deliver this for a substantial number of people? And what planning did you do so that we could limit the number? Because the numbers seem to be fairly high that aren't going to get the money. If, you know, I just think again, if we are trying to devise a system which we've all talked about, dignity, respect, all those words, we don't seem to be doing that with this new system.
So I will bring Janet back into that in terms of that expectations and communications. I would come back to the point of the extension of Scottish Child Payment to those under 16 is probably within the existing sort of devolution programme the biggest single intake of applicants we will ever have into a system. So how we transition that volume in at a single point in time is always going to be enormously challenging. We can't physically gear up or staff up to give the same level of service on week one or two than we will once that becomes a more business as usual activity. So these conversations were had routinely with Scottish Government. The way we develop our systems and our processes, part of the agile delivery is we've got interdisciplinary teams. So our staff work with Scottish Government on a constant basis around about the implementation of systems and what this means and the impact on the organisation. We've also become a really large, complex organisation now where you point to the communication. The communications we put out drive demand into the system. So we will have known that Facebook post would bring people into the organisation contacting us. So these things are done through the programme, through that delivery chain as part of a kind of integrated team. So when I say discussions with Scottish Government, what we don't do is a sort of letter exchange of, you know, this is what the impact will be. We are working with them around about it. But coping with that huge surge in demand on that first week was always going to be a huge challenge for us. And as I said, we didn't do what we did at the outset of take applications early. And the reason we didn't do that is that we needed the automation of the function to work and push cases through. And that's where Janet might just want to come in and say, you know, we need a level of automation in order for those cases to come through.
Okay, thank you. And yes, we do need that level of automation. And the other reason that we chose to do that launch this way is that so that some people would get their money before Christmas. That was the earliest date through the legislation that we could open for applications. And rather than say apply now and pay later, we knew it was important for some people to get their money before Christmas. I don't think we've ever said that everyone would. We've said that we realise that people would like that to happen. And part of what we're doing is managing people's expectations. And that particular Facebook post yesterday was in order to make sure that we could do that. We told clients they would get their benefits before Christmas. What we didn't want them to do was to assume that that would mean that would add the increase of Scottish Child Payment that they'd recently applied for. So it's a balance between managing clients' expectations, making sure they get the money that they need and that they know it will be backdated, which I accept at this time of year people would rather have the money now, but I don't think we ever promised that we would be able to deliver that to everyone this side of Christmas.
I'll leave it there, Camilla. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Move on to Miles Briggs to take us into our next theme.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to touch upon the Charter research and specifically with regards to improvements which the organisation are taking forward following that research. And I think it's worth saying, by and large, it was positive, but just wondered what learning you'd taken on from that.
So I think by and large it is positive, so I don't say that in any way to be complacent around about it. We also do need to remember that the Charter research reflects the financial year of 2021-22, so it is essentially speaking to a group of clients who haven't gone through the adult disability payment process. So with all of these things, it's a point in time. But I think, you know, coming back to some of the previous questions, the continuous improvement element around about it, I think, is the timescales. I think we're getting a clear indicator now that, you know, particularly during that point in time it was taken, we were at a point of timescales that people were finding unacceptable, and we needed to kind of improve on those timescales. I think, you know, it ties back to the communications point, both how we communicate with a broad range of clients, you know, whether we can do something smarter technology, and also whether there was a focus on particular groups that we need to communicate with slightly differently. So we've talked a lot about technology, and I would agree with the technology point. Technology will allow us to focus our scarce resource on those who most need it, if the majority of people can work through a system digitally by choice. So there's probably some things, again, I might bring Janet in just to say some of the working groups that's going on around about those communications element. But I think the thing which I personally took from it, I think, was back to the point that's been made here around about timelines. I think, you know, we need to focus on the continuous improvement of the organisation and that focus on timelines. I might come back and just say a little bit more then, but I'll let Janet come in on that.
Thank you. So, yes, probably the key thing for us, as David said, is that processing times, and particularly in the disability benefits space as much as anything. And I think it's just important to note that of all the case managers that we've recruited and trained and are delivering, we still have some who are not fully in that live service yet, so they will not be until the end of January. So we will start to see things progress and ramp up from the new year. But in addition to that, we have talked about how it is better for us to keep people informed and updated whilst we're still working through their claims. But one of the areas that we talked about in terms of communications was particularly how we communicate with older people in our communities. And our local delivery teams are out and about doing a lot of work, and they are doing a lot of cost of living events and warm hub events as well with stakeholders. So a lot of the work isn't just about improving our service, it's improving the contact we have with clients to make sure that what we deliver actually meets their needs.
That's helpful, thank you. And on that very point, with regards to signposting towards the Voice of Ability Advocacy Service, how have you taken that forward since we last met? There was obviously a lot of talk about recruitment of these individuals, and maybe just specifically for non-verbal clients, I wondered how that had been taken forward as well.
You go on.
Okay, so just in general, so absolutely, we've worked really closely with our Voice Ability clients. So they have also come to talk to the stakeholder group that we meet with regularly to make sure that not just us, but stakeholders are aware of the impact that they can have and what the services they deliver. And they have taken away some actions to work very closely with a couple of those groups. We also invited Voice Ability into the organisation to spend time with our client advisors, not just the ones on local delivery, but the ones on telephony as well, to make sure they're aware of the service. And we have appointed what we call advocacy champions within the organisation too, so they regularly keep new client advisors and teams up to date to remind them that they need to make sure that clients are aware there is an alternative to what we offer in terms of local delivery. Do you want to pick up a bit about that?
Just to say, I've met their Chief Executive, Jonathan Senker, on a couple of occasions as well. So much of the work that Janet's outlining there, we've been really keen to see the organisations working together. Clearly, we also need to do it in a way that protects Voice Ability's independence. So a lot of what we've been trying to do is link them up with stakeholders that we're already working with, as Janet mentioned, sort of stakeholder forums. So I think it's for us, it's about the advice for our clients can give with the awareness of it. And again, I think we want to increase that awareness of the service within our sort of client advisors as well.
Helpful, and it's not so much a question, but one of the things I think would be helpful for the committee is to find out data around where these individuals will be based as well. I don't think that's been clear. And also potential for home visits. That originally was being flagged as one of the key reforms, and I haven't been able to find out whether or not that's taken place or how many people have actually applied for that. So I don't know if that's within systems data you can provide as well.
Can I just, so there's Voice Ability doing some stuff and there's us doing some stuff. So clearly we, for that independent purpose, we don't manage the Voice Ability contract. We didn't let it and we don't manage it. So that's probably a point for Scottish ministers and policy colleagues to address, so we aren't cited, and I've got no input to where they put voice ability staff or how they're delivering those appointments. In terms of our local delivery staff, we now have those in all local authority areas of Scotland. With adult disability, their activity has been ramping up. We probably can give some of that data around about visits that they're undertaking, but I can absolutely confirm those home visits are happening where they're needed to happen. So we've got examples, you know, really strong examples of, you know, some of our local delivery client advisors going and repeatedly going out to a home visit if they feel that they need to provide additional support. And it is, I think, a really important difference in the system. You know, when we talk about PIP moving into adult disability, I always focus on you know, clinical assessments, you know, changing to be consultations internally, the application process and local delivery. So that providing support where people need it is really important. And you know, the government has invested in this organisation to resource up to enable that to happen. And in some ways, that should reduce the need for advocacy in some places, because we are helping people with their applications where they need it.
Thanks.
Thank you, Miles. Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. I wonder if I can just have a quick question around redetermination, and that is for child disability payment. I think, and correct me if I'm wrong, but as I read the figures, 85% of those that went for redetermination were granted. I wonder why you think that's such a high rate, and is certainly higher than used to be under the DWP scheme. So I'm just wondering what's happening with that first application looked by your staff.
So I'll say a couple of things, and I'll certainly let Janet say a bit more. Janet manages these redetermination teams. So again, I would just caution slightly against the direct comparison with DWP. We have always said that redetermination should be a step back from the case by people who've never been involved in the case before and looking afresh at it. The high level, I think, is probably, and Janet will say more about this, driven by additional information coming in. So I don't have figures to hand about what percentage of that percentage is driven by additional information, but it will be a significant high volume where we are gathering more information at the redetermination stage than we've had available to the people who made that first decision. There is also something probably here about just the newness of it. So as we, even when we looked at low income benefits, they would tend to be a sort of a higher redetermination level in the early days of it. And that again is just the organisation is new to this. We have got, you know, a new scheme, new policy, new staff. Everything that they touch is effectively for the first time in the early stages of this. But I would say predominantly that figure is driven by new evidence coming in at the redetermination stage.
I mean, one of the changes that was meant to happen under the scheme was that you would look for the information first time round. So clearly that's not happening. And I'm going to wonder what training is now being given so that it's not the claimant providing that information, but you're finding the information to get it right. And I mean, I am slightly, I mean, of all the application form and the way we apply it is different. The criteria for the awards has not changed at all in regard to child disability payment. So again, you know, I'm not quite sure. Yes, it's a new system, but it's not a new criteria. People are still getting an award on the same criteria. So, again, if you could just maybe tell me, you know, had the training not been there for the people? Why are they not going for that information first time round?
So I'll let Janet say a little bit more around about this, but you're right in terms of those that's part of the system, but the newness of everything else in the system. So there are changes to the system. There's changes in terms of being able to draw on the clinical expertise we've now got in the organisation, which doesn't exist in the DWP system. And the point, sorry if I didn't make it well, about newness, was the newness of the organisation. So, you know, we have roughly doubled in size every year the organisation has existed. So the people administering child disability payment and adult disability are new to the organisation. They've almost exclusively joined within the last year. They've almost exclusively joined during a period where COVID restrictions might have been in place as well. So inevitably, as we go on through that, people become more experienced and more efficient and more productive. But we do seek to try and get evidence up front. I'll maybe just come back and say one word, but I'll let Janet just say how that happens at a practical level.
Yeah, thank you. And I think when we're talking about the information as well, it's not necessarily information that we need to gather. Sometimes it's the information the clients were actually putting on the application form. And we realised very early on with child disability payment that for all the right reasons, we had made a lot of the application form and it was voluntary whether or not the client gave us that evidence. But we realised by the number of redeterminations that were coming in fairly quickly in that space that the client could have told us a lot more, which would have helped us make a different decision. I think it's fair to say that quite a significant number of that 84-85% of clients were actually receiving the benefit. Their redetermination was about the award rate that they wanted us to look at. So there was something for us about making sure the clients realised, and we changed the wording, particularly for the online application, about the more detail you can give us about the impact your condition or your disability has, the better. But we still do that supporting information gather on behalf of the client as well. But what we've also put in place since then is a step where we contact the client, both adult and child disability, when they make that claim, just to talk to the client a little bit more about, is there anything else you can tell us? A really good example of that is where we can spend weeks waiting for a GP surgery to send us a list of the medication that a client is on, whereas the client often has that to hand because they've got their repeat prescription and they could upload that information and send it to us. So it's not necessarily about us not looking for that information. We do. It's how we're gathering it, and we've learnt some really positive things from those early stages in child disability.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you, Jeremy. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. I have no further questions. It was the last question that's just been answered was the one I was going to ask. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Well, in that case, I will move back to Jeremy Balfour.
You may not be able to answer this, but I'm interested. The latest figures we got was under ADP, there were 1,845 new applications out of 3,545. That seemed quite a high figure. I just wondered, have you any early indication why there's so many new applications at this stage? And I'll come on to my second question in a moment, but yeah, just have you any idea why there's so many applications, or is that what you were expecting when you went live?
I don't have those figures in front of me, but Janet might come back to that. I think some of that, I saw a little bit of the earlier session in terms of the overall increase in applications across the UK. So what has been seen at a PIP level at UK, we are definitely seeing in a Scottish context as well in terms of increased applications. Anecdotally, I think we'd probably heard that the sort of the welfare advice, benefit advice sector had been a degree of storing up of applications. So people had been sort of deliberately not making an application under the DWP system if they were close to either a pilot area or the national going live in Scotland. So I don't think those figures are out of kilter with what we're anticipating. In fact, if anything, I think we saw a range. So we planned this on a sort of a high and a low range in terms of potential applications. Adult disability has more or less come in through the middle of that expected range. But sorry, do you have those numbers?
I don't have them to hand, but I think just what you said then, apologies, Mr. Balfour, I didn't understand the question until David just said. So I think what we did see was that spike initially, but when we look at the head of work, it is pretty much where we would have expected to be in what we call our average forecast for now. So it's pretty much tracking that week in, week out. So we probably saw that initial spike, which looked higher than we'd anticipated. But in terms of where we thought we would be now, it is about that average stage.
That's helpful. Just in regard to the kind of, you said in your earlier question, Matt, back in the summer, you took down the figure of when people would expect to hear from you in regard to both the initial decision and then the redetermination. I'm just wondering, what is your, if I apply, what is my expectation now for hearing in regard to the first decision, and then if I have to go to redetermination, how long that will take?
So I think from the most recent published statistics, we're in the region of around about 54 working days for a decision to be made. And that I think is still, as indeed is reflected in the SPICE figures, of a bit of an upwards trajectory. So that 54 days is based on the last month of that data being about 77 days. So we'd expect that to sort of stabilise and ideally come down. But that's the current sort of working time that we're looking at.
OK, and then just the final question around this is, just being very parochial in regard to the Lothians. Again, the figures that I see, that there's been 55 people who have gone from, been transferred from PIP to the new ADP. As not one of those 55, I'm just wondering, is that the speed of process you were expecting? Because it does seem quite slow. And have you got at least a working idea of when the full transfer will take place? Are you meeting the targets that we'd already had? Are you confident that everybody who's now on PIP will be transferred to ADP on the timescales that were we discussed previously?
Yeah, I think the challenge with those published figures, Mr. Balfour, was that it was a very, very early start of case transfer. So that was, as you've alluded to, a very deliberate, slow start so that we could check cases as they came in, check that we were getting the data and information we expected, and check that the process was working. So that has already significantly ramped up in terms of those numbers. There is a plan for the next, between now and end of 2024, to transfer all of those. There's nothing that we're seeing at the moment which suggests that's not achievable. There are points in there that does rely on quite significant volumes coming in a single month. So I think I think we would want to just check that we're able to manage those big capacities. So you're quoting 50 in a particular month. I think there's a month we get to about 30,000 or in that order. So at that point, we just want to make really sure. But it's the lag of the data, I think, is the problem with that particular stat, Mr. Balfour.
Thank you, Gavino.
Thanks, Jeremy. Theme 6 covers error and fraud, and I'll bring Pam Duncan-Glancy in.
Thank you, Convener. When the system was set up here in Scotland, obviously we'd said that it would be, or the Parliament at the time said that it would be fairer. And I'm slightly concerned about some of the work that I've seen around counter-fraud and surveillance. Can you tell us a bit more about the team that you've set up to do that? What are the sorts of things you're doing? The job description included things like covert surveillance, which made me quite uncomfortable. So could you tell me a little bit about that? And also, could you tell me how much you're spending on the counter-surveillance work?
So I will bring James in, who leads up that counter-fraud team, to kind of give a little bit more detail. I also would want to give some assurance around about actually what that feels like for clients in the system as well. So just to be absolutely clear, we will have fraud in the Scottish system. You know, that is undoubtedly the case. You know, any system of social security will have fraud in it. So our rationale for having counter fraud is to obviously, you know, limit and detect that. And you know, the surveillance function and the ability to counter that is designed as a kind of a disincentive there. It is the biggest element around about that will be organised fraud, and I'll let James say a little bit more around about how we're tackling some of those. But this is not about criminalising our clients in any way, shape or form, and you'll be clear with that in the terms of the passage of the bill. And we had, I think there was robust debate, you know, around about, you know, error versus fraud. So I would separate out error and fraud, indeed, as you have done. And you know, fraud is something quite specific and different, but it does exist, and we do need to tackle it. So we have got that full range of powers, including covert surveillance. It will be used incredibly sparingly. I'll maybe, so I don't say anything inappropriate, I'll let James just come on and say a little bit more about the team, the setup of the team, as far as he can, the cost of the teams, and what's that currently doing.
Thank you. I had a suspicion that we would cover this today. I think it is a factor of any benefit system that we will encounter fraud. My focus is organised crime that will attack our benefit system, and it is a definitive risk in the system. We have developed counter-fraud capabilities over the last number of years, and we have a suite of responses available to detect, prevent and address any fraud that we find in the system. We don't specifically release detail on the costs of the team because it would allow bad actors in the fraud space to size the team and size our fraud response. So we're very, very careful what we release, and it's not an attempt to be secretive or to lack transparency. It is so we're not undermining our counter-fraud efforts. Specifically on covert surveillance, I think the main thing that I would want to say there is that it is a highly regulated area. So these are statutory powers that we would be using where we're using or employing covert surveillance. It's the Regulation of Investigatory Powers Scotland Act 2000 is the piece of legislation that we're using that gives us our covert surveillance powers. And there are areas and tests and legislation that are set out where we can use those, and they are not used lightly and they are highly controlled. Social Security Scotland has a code of practice for investigations that we published in February 2020. It's available on our website that sets out for members or for clients exactly how we would use those covert surveillance powers. I think the vast minority of actors in the system that are seeking to defraud us, and covert surveillance is only used where it is legal, justified and proportionate, and frankly it's a last resort. It's where our other tactics have failed, and it is where there is significant theft from the public purse. This is not designed to covertly surveil an individual that has claimed Best Start grant fraudulently. These powers would never be used for that. Indeed, the powers and the capabilities of the team were set up to be available and developed for the launch of the larger, more costly benefits to the public purse, such as disability benefits. So if there was an industrial-scale fraud perpetrated against the organisation for disability benefits, it is a high-value payment, it's a regular payment. The losses to the public purse could be significant, and it then would probably be appropriate to, one, use all our available tactics to counter fraud, but then if they were exhausted, we may move to covert surveillance if that was entirely necessary, legal and proportionate. I'll stop there.
Thank you, I appreciate that. Can you describe the sort of organised crime that you're talking about?
It's where there is a coordinated, deliberate attack on the benefit system by someone who is not eligible for the benefit. So they are making deliberate misrepresentations to steal from the public purse. Those are the people that we're talking about. We're not talking about an individual who inadvertently makes an error on a form or ticks a box or even misrepresents themselves on a single occasion for a single benefit. Those are not the main threats in the system. It is organised crime. The scale of public money that we are responsible for in 2023-24, if you look to the recently published Scottish budget, is £5.1 billion. That is a significant element of public money. Unfortunately, fraud is a factor in our system. It is a vast minority of people, of individuals. I don't even call them clients because they are not eligible for our benefits. That's what makes this fraud. But it is people out in society who will seek to attack the public purse. And the scales of money that are involved require that we have powers that are commensurate with the response that's necessary to protect the public purse. Any pound that we save from a criminal's bank account can go to an eligible person or another Scottish Government policy imperative. And I think that's what's behind our counter-fraud approach. But the I recognise that these powers are strong and an assurance that they are not used lightly.
What evidence do you have of that kind of fraud and the likelihood of it happening?
So I think if I go back to the DWP, so the DWP have had their accounts qualified due to irregular payments for fraud and error for the last 30-something years. It is a factor and a long-standing factor of a benefit system. The levels of fraud are small. I mean, we're generally talking 1% of the benefit expenditure, but 1% of benefit expenditure is a lot of money. It's at a UK level, it could be £1 billion. At a Scottish level, it could be £50 million. It is a significant sum of public money that we ought to have steps to protect, and it would tend to be... Where it's organised crime groups, there are not that many of them that we're looking to guard against. But we must remain vigilant or we will lose money.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thanks.
Thank you, Pam. I'll bring Miles Briggs in for a supplementary, and then if you want to lead us on to your next set of questions as well. Thank you.
Convener, and it was linked to that point with regards to threats to the system, and I wondered and had noticed that the National Cyber Security Centre have been offering expert guidance to the organisation. So I wondered, have you had any cybersecurity breaches to date, and what strategies taking place to build in systems to prevent that taking place, especially given what we've seen organisations like SEPA recently?
So I'll answer that as best as I can, but I caveat that with I'm not technically minded. Our Chief Digital Officer would be happy to come and give some more in-depth detail of that. So, you know, since we've launched, we have had, as you say, we've been working with National Cybersecurity Centre at one point, embedded a kind of expertise building up. So ever since we've had a sort of a digital presence, we've had sort of teams monitoring those. There will always be attempts to kind of breach those securities, whether it's just by bots, whether it's by people in foreign state. It happens on an absolutely routine basis. I'm not consciously aware of any particular incidents that I would want to bring to the committee's attention in terms of cybersecurity, but we would never be complacent around about that approach. But it's a bit like the organised fraud point that James has outlined. We know any system that makes money available online will attempt to do some of those. And as soon as you put up a website, you will find it's automatically comes under an element of sort of test and attack, as it were.
No, that's helpful. And I think especially given new systems being put in place, it's important to build that in from the outset. And I believe Deputy First Minister has now put a reporting function in for all public agencies as well to report back to Scottish Government. And the theme I wanted to ask some questions on was with regards to new benefits and improving systems, and just wondered what scale of technical debt there currently is and what progress is being made to develop a structured approach to addressing that.
So our Chief Digital Officer has led putting a framework for sort of capturing technical debt in place. And again, what I should probably say from the outset is that technical debt, as I think is identified in the Audit Scotland report, it's a consequence of the agile approach. So we wouldn't look at technical debt and say there's a thing that should have been done that hasn't. It's a consequence of those minimum viable products, focusing on the delivery to citizens, but inevitably some functionality. Some of the stuff we've mentioned already today, a statistics function, an online portal for clients, these are things that in an ideal world we would want to see, as we've said, but we don't yet have. So Chief Digital Officers are in the process of capturing all of that information, capturing it, assessing it with our programme colleagues. And I'll maybe just turn to James in terms of, because I think the point is around about the financial elements of that. So that capture is around about functionality. And James, I don't know if you want to say anything about how or when that might get translated into some financial figures.
I can. So I think over time is the answer. I think we have a standardised approach to assessing investment decisions in the agency, that we would always look to, does any proposal to service technical debt or any particular piece of technical debt, how much is it going to cost, how much is it going to pay back, what is the value for money assessment of servicing that piece of technical debt. So there will be a process that will need to be gone through once the sort of initial process of devolution is complete, to analyse what do we wish to fix, where are the benefits, what's it going to cost, and where might we not wish to service it because it doesn't pay back, but it's not good value for the public purse. So those arrangements are fairly standard in government, and it is, they're already in place, and it will be that cycle of sort of continuous improvement that the agency moves into, where we make investments that are value.
That's helpful, thank you. I think my final, if you answered some of the questions with regards to the need for additional data, do you have time scales or timelines for when you think that will be fixed and put in place to be able to draw down on that data or have those data sets which can then be used?
So for the Fiscal Commission specific asks, yes, we're trying to do that for the next round of forecasting, as I say, and that work has started. So last week we were starting to see what those reports look like. Our analysts are then sort of quality assuring. So our commitment to the Fiscal Commission is to try and do that for the next round of forecasting. As I said earlier on, the longer work with users, to determine, what the community of stats users for this data looks like in Scotland. Fiscal Commission will be one, some academics will be others, so we will gather that sort of stakeholder group around and see what the ask is. And again, it's back to what can be achieved and when. But that is a longer term bit of work. But for the Fiscal Commission, we are committed to try and do that for the next round of forecasting, which will be early into the new year.
That's helpful. And you can maybe keep the committee updated as well on that, because we've been having a watching brief. And just finally, since the internal audit report in July, what sort of guidance and training has been taken forward from that? And since our visit, where's your strategy or policy around working from home? I know that was something we discussed, a number of people back in new buildings, for example, in Dundee and things.
I'll cover the training point, and I'll maybe bring Janet in on the training point and then go to the hybrid working. So from a guidance and training perspective, I mean, I think it was highlighted in the Audit Scotland report because it was, a particular risk in the run-up to adult disability. And again, there is a feature of the way that we're delivering this, that guidance inevitably comes to us late. And again, that's not a criticism of anything. That's just a feature of the system we've got. So there is a real challenge in terms of getting people brought onto guidance. Bits might be missing from that guidance which aren't required for day one. So back to, the redetermined guidance may not be there on day one because it's not seen as a day one function. So you're then into a cycle of continually training people, the guidance changing. And even as we train people in there, the system that they're training on doesn't necessarily reflect the LAIS system. So we're having to put people through, training on a system in one place with guidance. When they come out to consolidation, that will look different. When they come out into live, that may look slightly different as well. So I think that's the risk that they were highlighting. It was very specific around about, I think, at the time, the benefit launch of adult disability payments. So that has dissipated for now. It will come back up, particularly when we go into the next big benefit launch. Possibly less so for winter heated payment, but will certainly for the replacement of carers allowance, for example, it will come back on board again. So there's some improvements we can make, and Janet might just want to say how we're doing some of that consolidation training in particular around about guidance. But the nature of what we have does mean guidance will continually change, and that is a challenge for the organisation, that there is a continually challenge of moving guidance, and we're having to sort of train people all the time on that. But Jan, I don't know if you wanted to briefly say anything on that training aspect.
I think you've probably covered most of it. It is very much, we learn as we go along, but I think the more experienced we become in the agency, we're more able to influence the design of that training from the beginning, which of course at first we weren't. So a lot of our feedback from current or previous training goes into that, and it is in a much more stable place than it was.
Just to have time in the hybrid point. Or so I think at the time that you were in the organisation, we were probably still sort of trialling some of these approaches. Where we've alighted on is we do want to become a hybrid organisation, so we are deliberately not moving to a fully, you know, remote working from home environment. We think there's something quite important, particularly given where we are in our development of getting our teams together for the reasons of training, the reasons of development, the reasons of just kind of building and maintaining that culture. So we have said to all of our colleagues that hybrid is the approach that we're looking for. People will roughly sort of fall into a category as to whether, you know, how mobile they are, you know, whether the local delivery, for example, would look different. And we have set a clear expectation that we would expect to see people up to 2 days a week in an office. And that is a ratio that essentially means that the estate that we've got can support the workforce that we've got. At the moment, we're seeing around about a 50% occupancy, so we would want to drive that higher in the new year. But hybrid is the approach we've taken. We've been reasonably directive around about saying we do want to see people in, and we are convinced as a management team that, you know, there are benefits in seeing people in the office. And I think people who are in the office are also now starting to see those benefits as well.
No, thank you. And just finally, I wanted to ask, we had the Minister with regards to winter heating payments saying his expectation was all clients would be paid in February. Do you think the system's in place to make that happen?
So again, The kind of the just-in-time nature of this means that, you know, there will be an element of us needing to see the data, how much drops out of that. There will be a challenge as to how much manual intervention is required. Janet, again, I might just briefly bring in, because again, as I said in a previous answer, we are working, you know, hand in glove with our programme colleagues as we do that as a multidisciplinary team. So, you know, we've built up resources based on what we think at the moment, and we think we've got the right resources to do that. There's still a, you know, a requirement for DWP data, and then seeing what that data looks like.
Yeah, we'll get that data through in January, so we'll have a better idea then. But as David said, we have got the resource that we think will require already in training around that, but we have got additional resource that we can use to try and make sure that as many clients as possible get that payment in February. But it is reliant on us getting the data in time for us to do that.
Thank you very much, Miles. And our last questions are coming from James Dornan.
It's been over a year since the launch of your local delivery service. Could you reflect on how it's going, what you've learned, and how involved have the local delivery teams been in the constant improvement theme?
So I'll say a couple of words, and I'll definitely ask Janet to reflect on that as well. You're right, it's been over a year, but in essence, you know, adult disability, I think, has been the real element which has brought local delivery to the fore. I'm incredibly proud of some of the work that's been done in local delivery. I think what we are seeing, as I briefly mentioned earlier, clients who would not otherwise have completed an application form being practically assisted to do so. So one of the founding sort of principles of what we are trying to do here, of assisting people to get the benefits that they are entitled to, we are seeing local delivery actively working on now to do that. The way they've done it, I think, is really important as well. So, you know, we of course have to, you know, be mindful of resource and an element of triaging that, but where necessary, we have had people in people's homes, we've had people in islands, we've had people on sparsely populated islands taking ferries and, you know, ultimately, you know, putting their wellies on to get to the places that they need to be. And we've seen those leads engaging with local authorities, engaging with local kind of voluntary organisations and becoming part of that kind of support community. And I think in some instances, hopefully, we've also seen those local delivery leads engaging with local MSPs and MPs and getting engaged in surgeries or workshops there as well. So I'm personally incredibly proud. I've probably missed some of the important stuff that they're actually doing. So I'll maybe just let Janet have a quick word on that.
Okay, thank you. And yeah, and I think you've covered most things, David. There are a couple of key things I think it's important for us to highlight. That team in particular have been very supportive of people coming across from the Ukraine. They've been working on the ships with people, and we have received quite a number of claims which they've taken on behalf of people from Ukraine and supported them through the Scottish Government's benefits system. They're also involved in pilots in certain areas. Dundee is one in particular where we're looking proactively there at reducing child poverty. So they are linking in with Dundee Council and with DWP in the area to work through cohorts of clients that perhaps all of us come into contact with to make sure they're receiving everything that they're entitled to. So the local delivery team is doing much more than just going out and helping people to fill in a claim form. They are part of an integral part of the communities across Scotland.
Thank you very much for that. Thank you.
Thank you, James. And can I say thanks once again for attending this morning and for giving us your evidence. We will now move into our private session. And can members who are joining us remotely please use the Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting. Thank you.